So we started with the supply analysis in the previous video, and we'll be discussing some more topics related to supply analysis in this session. So let's start. Now look at this table. The first column indicates the quantity produced, and then I have the total fixed costs. So what are total fixed costs? Total fixed costs are nothing but they include expenses like rent, the lease amount for the facility, or the amount that you spent on furniture, equipments, etc. And then you have the total variable costs, and these costs vary according to the quantity produced. So higher the quantity produced, higher would be the variable cost. And finally, you have the total cost, which is equal to total fixed costs plus the total variable costs. So if I look at this graph, my total fixed cost is a straight line because it is a constant value until I reach my maximum capacity. So this is my total fixed cost, and then this is my total variable cost, and finally I have my total costs. Now let's go a little bit more into detail. So have a look at this table. In this table I have calculated the average total costs, the average fixed costs, the average variable costs, and the marginal costs. So my average total cost is equal to the total cost divided by the quantity produced. So here I have the total cost. So this divided by the quantity produced, which is equal to 1. Likewise, 120 divided by the quantity produced gives me 60. So this is how I calculate my average total cost. Likewise, my average fixed cost is equal to the total fixed cost divided by the quantity produced. So here I have the fixed cost. So my average fixed cost would be the total fixed cost divided by the total quantity produced. So 100 divided by 2 gives me 50. So this is how I calculate my average fixed cost. And then I have the average variable cost. So average variable cost is equal to the total variable cost divided by the quantity produced. So I have my total variable cost here. So 30 divided by the quantity produced, that is 3, gives me the average variable cost of 10. And then I have the marginal cost. So marginal cost is the incremental total cost with every unit increase in production. So I calculate my total cost here. I have my total cost here. So I use this to calculate my marginal cost. So in the first case, my marginal cost will be 120 minus 110. That gives me 10. This is my incremental cost. Likewise, suppose I take this case. So 175 minus 150 gives me 25. So this is how I calculate my marginal cost. Now if I look at the graph, my graphs are something like this. So this is my average fixed cost. So my average fixed cost decreases as and when I increase the quantity produced. Likewise, this is my marginal cost. So you can see that my marginal cost slightly increases and then it drops till I reach a certain point, and after that my marginal cost increases. So if I look at my data here, my marginal cost, initially it increases and then it decreases, and after that it reaches the minimal point. So in this case my minimal point is 10. And after that, again, my marginal cost increases. So this is my minimum marginal costs. And then I have my average total cost. So this is my average total costs. And finally, I have my average variable costs. So this is how the graphs for average total cost, average fixed cost, average variable cost, and marginal cost looks like. Now let's take an example. Suppose I run a very small yoga center, and with all the social distancing norms in place, suppose I can accommodate 5 members in my center. Let's keep the number small so that it's easier to understand. So you can see 5 members here. So this means that I'm operating at my full capacity and I am at the optimal point of production. Now, let's try to analyze the costs associated with this. So, I have my x-axis. My x-axis indicates the quantity. So, in this case, the quantity is the number of customers that I have in my yoga center. And then on the y-axis, I have costs per customer. Now, this is my average total cost curve. And initially, I have 5 customers, which means that I'm operating at full capacity. And for 5 customers, suppose my total cost is $50 per customer. Okay. Now, let's see what happens. Suppose my number of customers reduce from 5 to 3. Now, in the short run, I cannot make any changes in my fixed capacity, which means I cannot suddenly shift my rental space or dispose unused equipment. So, my fixed cost would not change, which increases the average total cost per customer. So, let me look at this graph now. So, on the x-axis, I have quantity, which is the number of customers, and on the y-axis, I have cost per customer. This is my average total cost curve. And here, initially, I was operating at 5 customers and my cost was $50 per customer. But now my quantity has decreased from 5 to 3, and I remain on the same average total cost curve. But now you can see that my cost has increased from $50 to $70 per customer. Okay. Now, let's take another scenario. Suppose my market share expands, and apart from operating at full capacity, now I have 3 additional customers. So I have 5 customers in this room, and then I have 3 additional customers. I do not want to lose them because it's not good for my business in the long run. So I rent additional space on a temporary basis for these extra customers in the short run. So again, there is no change to my fixed cost, but my variable costs have increased due to these additional 3 customers. So again, this would add to my total cost. And since I do not make any change to my original fixed capacity, my average total cost curve in the short run would still remain the same. So let's see what happens here. So on the x-axis, I have quantity, which is the number of customers. On the y-axis, I have cost per customer. This is my average total cost curve. So initially, I was operating at 5 customers, and then I shifted to 3 customers. But now I have 8 customers, and you can see that my cost per customer has increased to $90 per customer. Okay. Now let's see what happens in the long run. So let me draw my graphs again. So this is my short-term average total cost curve when I was operating at 5 customers with a cost of $50 per customer. Okay. Now, if I know that my market is only 3 customers and not 5 customers, then I can shift my fixed capacity to a smaller space. So this can definitely happen in the long run. So this means that instead of leasing a space for 5 customers, I would go for a smaller space to accommodate only 3 customers. So here I have 3 customers, and because I'm leasing this space for a longer time period, my fixed cost would come down, and now I move to a new cost curve, as you can see here. And I would be optimally operating at only 3 customers, and my average total cost for 3 customers would be lower than the $70 which we saw earlier. So now, say for example, it's only $65. Okay. Likewise, when I consider a longer time period and I know that my quantity demanded over the long run is 8 customers, then I can shift from a space of 5 members to a bigger space of 8 members. So here I make a new investment and I dispose of my original fixed capacity of 5 members. And now, since I have made major changes to my fixed capacity, I can now move to a new cost curve where I will be optimally operating at 8 customers. So here my average total cost for 8 customers is $80 instead of the $90 that we saw earlier in the short run. So in the long run, we can see that we can always change our fixed capacity based on the optimal points of production. So here we saw that for three customers, I can pick a smaller room. For five customers, I can pick a medium space. And for eight customers, I can pick a larger space. So in the short run, I cannot customize my space or my fixed capacity based on the quantity of my demand. But in the long run, I can customize my fixed capacity based on the quantity demanded or the quantity of production. So which means that in the long run, I can always choose to operate at minimum average total cost, which is optimal for me. So suppose I mark all my points here and I remove all the extra lines. So now if I join all the minimal points on my average total cost curves, I can get my long run average total cost curve. So here the green curve is the long run average total cost curve. Now there are several reasons why I can choose to operate on lower costs in the long run. First of all, I have better bargaining power over the labor unions. So because of which I can get labor at less cost. I can also get better prices for raw materials, and I can enjoy the benefits of higher experience levels and higher skilled workers due to higher production levels. I can have lower transportation costs and lower distribution costs. I can get better interest rates from banks because I'm considering longer time periods here. And finally, I can have less fixed costs due to leasing over longer periods of time.